You touched on it. Is Monroe capable of that kind of love?
I'd like to think that anyone is. And I think that, like, in playing any character, you have to assume that they are, but it's just how hard you have to dig in order to find it. And I think that in Monroe, it would take not only a massive leap of faith and a bridge in him, but also in someone else. So he would only be able to love someone as much as they are prepared to love him. And when you're the former dictator of a megalomaniacal regime such as the Monroe Republic, it would be very difficult for anyone to say, like, let's go on a couple of dates and see where this is going to go. So is Monroe capable of feeling it? Yes, but only so much as someone else is capable of giving it.
He's constantly denying his real identity. Is he wanting to shirk that and reinvent himself a little bit?
Yeah, I think that, like, he's a character that keeps switching and changing. And I think that it is still tethered to the same aspect of himself, which is loneliness, or there's a chasm there, there's a void there. Interestingly enough, like, in the second season, it's kind of masked by this snarkiness, this I don't give a hoot. In Texas, I can say that. I don't give a hoot. But he does so much. So much about Miles. So much about their, deep down, their acceptance of him. But he's got this kind of weird, like, push me, pull me attitude. But it's, and this, the same guy that was screaming to his friend to take him back and to explain why he treated him in such a way, in that petulant sort of manner, is the same guy that is hanging around this group, keeps coming back to this group, and then saying how much he doesn't need them. There's something in that. There's something in that that Rachel picks up, that a few people think, I was like, what are you doing? You know, do you think you can go and lead the world? Go and lead the world. What do you, I constantly, you know, Monroe constantly says, I need Miles, I need Miles. And even his son says, like, what for? But I think that that acceptance is kind of very much at the heart of that character. And I still question as to how much he really wants the power, as opposed to how much he really wants to fill the void.
Together with Neville and Jason and everyone, how does Monroe kind of fit within the group? Is he constantly watching his back, or is he, do they have a common fight? And
they hate him. They really hate him. And it's kind of interesting because, like, in every scene we play, it's always like me saying something snarky or really rude to a lot of the characters. They're like, dude, like, put it away. And I think that he's the irritant in it. And I think that he's, what we're starting to see is that in doing so, he's just getting in there close to Miles and he's in his ear. I think that in the latter half of this season, you'll start to see him just get a little bit closer. And in those moments of Miles' vulnerability, he'll just say a couple of things which will say, you know, which will align himself with Miles and say, what are you doing? What are you doing with these guys? I mean, you say you want this. You say you want to take down the Patriots. Why? Why do you want to take, you know, why are you living this kind of heroic lifestyle? What's the end game? And I think that is one of the great things between that relationship is that Miles is uncertain of really where this is all leading, whereas Monroe is kind of a little bit more clear. It's leading probably back to a Monroe Republic, and he can see it. Maybe it's going to be better this time, but he needs Miles to do it. But I think that there's, I think in terms of his relationship with that group, Rachel pulls him this way, Charlie pulls him this way, Monroe gets him closer, starts to pull him in a different direction.